maintenance. This project was sponsored through the Ohio Department of Transportation and the Federal Highway Administration. It was completed by the University of Akron. I ask that you save your questions to the end of the presentation. And with that, I will give it over to Dr. Bill Schneider with the University of Akron.
I'd like to thank everybody for coming here today. I'm Bill Schneider. Terry Cutright is right there. She, as we kind of go through this, we did an infield and a lab. My side was responsible for the infield. Terry's group was responsible for the lab work. Mallory Crow was one of our students on there. Andrew Pelfrey was another one. And then we had a bunch of other students along the way. In terms of here we are from a technical panel, Frank Phillips Jr. is here. John Washko's down at the end, who was also part of the main group. And then you can see we have the research office there as well. And then in addition to that, we had Chardon's crew helped us for a while in terms of setup of our equipment. And then we ran in the second half, we ran everything through the Boston Heights garage as well. So that's our team that was part of this project. Okay, so this has been a multi-year project. It wasn't supposed to be that long, but the bottom line was we didn't get a whole lot of great. I have to be careful how I say this. The weather wasn't horrifically bad for testing a lot of deicers in the road. So if you're a researcher like me, that's bad. If you're the traveling public and others, that's probably a good thing. So as we looked at this, and so we wanted to look things that rank reasonable in cost. The reality of it is if it's a fantastic product and it's 20 times more expensive than everything else, we're probably not going to be able to use that. It's going to be too expensive. Likewise, if it does, it turns all of our lakes and rivers red, that's probably not good as well. So we had a couple things that we had to discuss there. And then we also wanted to look at what's the feasibility, if you will, of implementing a particular de-icer in the field moving forward. Okay, so a couple things. These were the de-icers that we tested and we used brine as a control. A couple caveats to know. One is, with the exception of today, our team had no idea which de-icer was which de-icer, and to this point, even Dr. Cutright has no idea what any of these were. And when we talked about results and field applications, nobody at ODOT has been exposed to which de-icer result is with which one. This project will be finished September 1. The final report will specifically link the finals today. We're just going to see A, B, and C, but you'll get an idea of how this is coming. Back end, about, let's see here, this is probably 2-3 years ago this project started, and we went out and we asked vendors around to say, we had a survey that we asked. And then through that survey, vendors were allowed to participate in this project. One of the key caveats of this project was once the original de-icers were selected, we did not add new ones in the upcoming year. So if a vendor had a new product, we didn't test it. This is what it was when it started, and as we move forward. Okay, so the project setting and equipment. Basically, we're going to look at a few settings today. One was no traffic on the road in field. The second one was a little bit of traffic on the road. The third one was low traffic on the road that we did in Chardon. And the last one was what we did was a low to moderate level amount of traffic flow. Bottom line is, and you guys have participated in the winter in Ohio the last few years, it's been mild. You know, it is what it is going forward. keep wanting to punch that, and that's the wrong one. Going forward. So the first thing that we did, and this was a few years ago, is we wanted to just get you comfortable working with the generic application. So we built one here. This is a small wagon that we looked at, had a 2.5 gallon tank for the deicers, 5 gallon to flush it, the spray bar, and then we had a flow meter calibration with it. The reason why we did this setup is because this deployment down here at the bottom is very similar to what Chardon would run and what ODOT would run in terms of just dropping it down. It's not spraying it out, it's just dropping it down as we looked at it. So, and this was done again. This is the second one that we did. As you can kind of see, we're stepping it up. This was built in Chardon. So again, much thanks to the Chardon crew for helping us develop this. What you can see on here is that we have a calibrating spray bar at the bottom. We have a hydraulic pump system. And then up here, we have a combination of the deicers. And then we had a quick connect in that we would spray everything with brine afterwards. The thought was is we're trying to get it as close as we could to what the DOT would do. And again, the setup was approved by, again, our technical panel. So this is what we applied on the low volume roads and the medium volume roads as we went through. Unfortunately, in this study, we were never able to go to full-blown, you know, Route 8, interstate, big truck. We just didn't get to that enough data at the end, the colder temperatures to really go. And I think, frankly, if I was to ask Jill for another extension, I'd probably be buried under a garage at some point. So at some point, we just had to say, okay, here's where we got to, and kind of open it up. Again, on all these scenarios, we tried to do it as best we could. And in most scenarios, we did calibrate. So we tried as hard as we could to get to what the vendor specific application rate would be. And we modified it accordingly. So if we were pulling in the wagon, if we were doing it on one of these trucks, that we got it as close as we could. Okay, on the back end side, so the data collection side, we really looked at a few things. The first is the bottom left is a T2GO portable friction tester. And on the right-hand side of this is a Marwis road sensor. We went through a bunch of the literature. We talked to a fair amount of people. And for the budget we had at the time, this was about as good as we could do. The T2GO in the bottom left was about, I want to say, $15,000, give or take. And the Marwis was, I want to say, $5,000. Ish. We did notice that when you're talking, you can spend $100,000 on a contraption, a built-in, a car that's got all sorts of stuff that you would see on a on an airport runway. But ultimately, we decided that this was going to be as good as we can. There are some limitations to both. At one point, we thought about doing a full-blown pull-behind trailer friction wheel. Ultimately, that was one that we decided not to go with. Okay, the third one that we looked at is we had an infrared camera to look at as well. The bottom line, and you can see it, this is some pictures that we took in the field on the right-hand side. This is a cul-de-sac, no traffic. You can just see the wagon wheels, and then you can see the application associated with it. And then you can see right next to it, here's the corresponding friction, or sorry, temperature that was going with it. One of the caveats that we're gonna say throughout this is we're not necessarily saying, we're just recording temperatures of the system. Okay, so So the no traffic volume road, this was just the first one. We wanted to get comfortable with the deicers. At no point are we suggesting to anybody that this is how we're going to do the final deicer application, using a wagon, doing something like that. What we wanted to do, though, is we wanted to expand a little bit more from a parking lot study or some study where they maybe spray 3 feet by 3 feet. We tried to get it a little bit bigger. And again, when you look at this, this would be similar to how ODOT would be placing the liquid, their liquids down. We would measure out a distance, we would time it, we would calibrate the system to take a look as best as we could to get decent data. No traffic road on the right hand side. Again, this was done initially in Boston Heights. So Brian would go ahead and we were just experimenting with different hard packs, different scenarios that we could do, and then look at different mixtures and things of that sort. Bottom right, that's Brian that burned it off. The left-hand side, you can see different cones in there. This was just a control, as you can see. And again, is this a real-world scenario? No. But I wasn't comfortable with right off the bat freezing Route 8 and creating trouble. So this was just us to get to know the product moving forward. Again, this was the setup that we would have. We had a series of zones. We would, in all cases here, we did a serpentine style going through, and we would try to attract as many deicers as we can. We pay attention to, as best as we could, that prevent any mixing. And between each deicer application, we would flush it with brine. We had discussions with that with our technical panel, and they were comfortable that flushing with brine is an acceptable way to clean the system. Again, no roads. Again, the ice are pulled, uniform speed, flushed every test. Measurements were taken throughout the zone at 15-minute intervals as best as we could. Other ones, this picture was taken at about 1 o'clock at night. And we had some challenges here. We had some decent snow in that back end. We were experimenting at the zero volume, both with, hey, let's just see if we could burn it off, to, hey, should we plow it and then treat it, all sorts of different scenarios. And then one of the other challenges that we had, and again, I have to thank both Boston Heights and Chardon, was, hey, guys, in the middle of a storm, would you mind leaving the road that you're currently working on, come over to our spot, take care of a situation and go back. So I'm very appreciative of both areas for that. What we showed here, right off the bat, we plowed. We showed right there that there was no real change in the friction that any of the deicers when we looked at this. And then what we basically said here is that right off the bat, the deicers required either sunlight or friction to melt. But really what it is, you need traffic volume. That's what we were coming to, you know, mix it on the road. What we did notice a lot with a lot of the deicers is, even if you poured a cup right here, right off the bottom, it was a very liquidy mixture right on the ground. That's saying it would work. It's not about that. It wasn't burning it off the way other things would do. And then ultimately, the reality of it is most of our roads are going to have some traffic. And that's what we started seeing is when we did some simulated. When you got that tire going, it started mixing everything up, making things work in a good manner, and go from there. So what we did the second time around is, after we realized that the cul-de-sac, which you can see up here, we had to expand it. So we started doing some different zones, switching them around as best we could. And what we started doing is just driving back and forth and working that deicer product right on in and then we got, it was working, and it was, I'm going to call it slippery, but that's not really the word I would use. It was definitely working. It's just, I can't explain the way that would be. And you can see the mixture on the right. Now, the other thing to consider is, you know, as you're talking about a high volume road with high speed, that mechanical interaction between the wheel and the road and the mixing, that's pretty aggressive and would definitely fan it out and spread it out going forward. Okay, so these are some basic results that we saw at different spots, and we varied, again, so this was in 15, we varied, you know, as much as we could. There are some different deicers going through, and again, the black is the controlled brine that we looked at as well. And then all we were doing there, since these are smaller roads, we looked at the T2Go. You can see him pushing it there. We varied both throughout this application. Should we plow and then put it down? Should we just see what happened if we just put it down across the board? And we tried to keep things in good working order. Caveat, right there you see the A through H and the control. None of the field people knew which deicer it was. And to this point, still ODOT has no idea which deicer in the final report. We'll go into link them, but again, throughout the whole project, so there was no bias between the technical panel and the group in terms of how we were doing this. Low volume road. So once we started looking at it, and really the big takeaway we got across the board with all the deicers, or with basically everything, is you need some volume, you know, to really mix it in and get it working. So what we did is we went up to Chardon. Chardon has the luxury of getting a whole lot of snow every winter. So that seemed like a good spot to start. So we went up there and we looked at three low volume roads with Chardon support. Again, the truck that you see here was built with our team and the help of Chardon to, again, best replicate what would be done in the field. A couple caveats that we should be aware of, that when we applied, we didn't do anything special to the road before or after any application, because the reality of it is, whether it's ODOT or Chardon or somebody else, no one's going to wash the streets between runs. We try as much as possible to avoid any contaminations going forward. And what we did here in the low volume roads, and you can see that we had three roads in Chardon that we were looking at, and you can see that on the right hand side, and we had a few tests. One thing that happened throughout the test is we had to balance the deicers working, how long they would work, and then when do I have to plow? And then ultimately on top of that, hey, John's got a job to do outside of research, so try not to get in the way of his team. So we had to, you know, match that as best as we could as well. But you can kind of see there, the three, we had random temperatures, 17 to about 32 degrees, 1-2 inches of snow. Unfortunately, again, as I've said a few times already, we didn't have at any part of the study 5-degree weather and big snow to really, you know, most of the field work was 15, 18, 20 degrees above. Unfortunately, a lot of times the pavement temperatures, because we didn't have a horrifically cold winter, limited us. And that happened last year too. We didn't, you know, they were both mild winters. So I think that's something to keep in consideration. We saw, this is an example of, so when we went to low volume road, we went with the Marwis, we dropped the T2Go for a couple reasons. One is with the Marwis, we could put it right on the truck, we could calibrate it there, we didn't have to have students or other employees in the road at the time, so we were trying to minimize that as much as possible. So what you can see is on the left-hand side, this is our friction versus time from the first application. Now, again, some of the challenges that we had is the application may be working, but we had to go back and plow. I mean, it just was, there's a balancing act. And then what we see over here on the right-hand side is where we took different field measurements throughout some of these studies. So those are the way that we would look at this. Okay, so we did a few tests in Chardon, and then after a while, we realized we had to drop down the Boston Heights for a couple reasons. I think one big reason was Frank's team has more manpower, so that kind of helped us out a little bit. Caveat on the medium volume roads is, again, we were still limited to work within the confines of the Boston Heights garage. If it started snowing and started sticking, we were plowing. I mean, that's just the bottom line as we went forward. Okay, so what did we do? We had Route 303, which is right off of Route 8. You can kind of see the slivers of Route 8 over here. I'm going to put you guys on the spot. Do you have any idea what the ADT of 303 is?
I would say 10,000, somewhere there.
So 10,000 plus or minus. So again, obviously we've come a long way from a cul-de-sac with no traffic that we're trying to figure out to a bigger deal road. Then what we did here is, here's our list of this last year, all the days that we went out. Then what we have here is here's our range of temperatures. Here's our corresponding snowfall that was associated with it. And then one of the other things that I want to make sure we try as best as possible between each de-icer. So these are the different zones. And you can see here, as best as possible, we tried to randomize which de-icer was applied in which zone, so that if there was a zone that had a magical something, that at least each de-icer would have a turn in there. And again, we took about 29 tests, and you can kind of see here would be the zone, and then here we would drive through. We would do the twofold one is with an ODOT. ODOT would help us spray it, set it down, and then we would take our friction measurements with the Marwis device as we were going through. Additionally, and this would be just some examples, so this would be an example on 12/11/2016. We took time after application, so that's hours, so we were watching it. You start seeing it fail, you start seeing it bounce back up. And at the same point, we would go through multiple times and we would take pictures as both the thermal image as well as the photo to just try to get an idea. And then again, in most cases, whatever Boston Heights said, we're plowing or we're doing something else, test was over. Like there's no, you know, so could we have extended some of this, maybe, you know, a few more hours? It's possible. But ultimately, say we had to watch the traveling public and we just called the zone. So this is just an example of one. Another thing that we looked at is through the thermal imaging. And so you would get, here's the thermal image. Then what we would do in the thermal images is we would normalize a different section within each. So each section would be the exact same size, and each section would have the exact same number of pixels. And then remember from the previous graph, here, we randomized as best as we could. So if there was a good one or a bad one, it got distributed out. We took the random pixels, again, made sure that they were good. Then we went back and did some image processing. And what we're looking at here and what we're continuing to do as part of Mallory's work is that she's looking at the distribution of the color changes associated with it. So in theory, the warmer it is, the better the product is doing over that extended time. So we've had discussions before, okay, well, some start off fast and warm it up and then die down. Some are a slow, then a high burn or whatever it is. It was captured over, you know, if the test was 4 hours long, it captured all of it. And again, we're not suggesting at all in this that this is time dependent. It's basically going back to each one of these different loops. So you can see We took points here, here, here. You can kind of see every time we went through a zone, when did we take that? And again, that was processed back through there. So we have the various deicers A, B, and C. And then here's the other ones going through. We're still doing a little bit of work on this, but we're just trying to show, do the color changes vary? So we had friction, we have temperature, we have some other things that were, you know, just visual views of it that we were looking at. In addition to that, Terry's gonna talk to you about the lab. One of the things, as she comes up, one of the things that we had an issue with is wait, we really didn't have cold temperatures, and we really didn't have, we really didn't have cold temperatures to look at this. So what we were trying to do, in a perfect world, I would have loved to have said, we have 70 events, we had 30 below 10 degrees, we had 30 between 10 and 20, it just didn't work. So one of the things that we did, about March-ish, maybe January-ish.
January, she goes, are you busy? Can you help me out in the lab?
Yeah, so she came in and started looking at, can we do some additional testing in the field? Because the goal was trying to get down into some of those lower tests. And again, what I want to stress to the group here, even as of today, Terry has no idea which deicer is which deicer. And on that note,
Didn't even know what the possible list was until he showed that slide. Down arrow?
The left and right arrow.
Okay. So the first test we did was the freeze point test, ASTM D1177-12. And on the right-hand side is the image of the cooler apparatus that was used to do the test. For those of you that are familiar with it, you put the proper refrigerant in the doer. The freeze tube has the deicer, and then we set the strokes going to keep it mixing. And we had a thermocouple wire that was in the solution. We measure the time every second to figure out what was the lowest temperature that things would freeze. The majority of, and on the left-hand side are the graphs of the deicers. Six out of the seven, for the most part, the pure deicer exhibited the lowest freeze point. And then when you cut it, then the freeze point would get warmer. For instance, on the top, we have deicer D in purple that had a freeze point of minus 7 Fahrenheit. And when it was 75% of the deicer, it had increased to roughly minus 5. The best performing of the deicers that followed that trend was deicer G, which is the blue triangle, that had a freeze point and pure temperature of a pure condition of minus 35 Fahrenheit that increased to minus 22 when we had 75% of the deicer. The one deicer that followed a different trend, okay, so the first six used as a refrigerant a mixture of ethanol, which was interesting to keep the students from not trying to drink it, and dry ice. When we did deicer H, it had pure condition a minus 35 freeze point, and as it was cut, it got colder. We had to use liquid nitrogen as refrigerant to do that test. We didn't do it for the entire time for the additional cut because it kept breaking the nice little glass containers. We would put it in there and freeze, but as it was brought out and getting back to room temperature, it would fracture the glass. So deicer H is the only one that followed the opposite trend. The second test we did with the ice penetration, SHRPH-205.4 for the liquid deicers. We made the specifications for the machine shop using acrylic as per the methodology. The test requires 5 replicates, so we could do 2 replicates at a time, I mean 2 tests at a time. And you start off the test, we use the syringe to fill deaerated RO water from the bottom of the test sample to the top for all 10 sample containers, put it in the freezer at the specified temperature for a minimum of 2 hours. Then we would take an aluminum plate to go across the top to make sure it was flush. Then it went back into the freezer overnight to make sure it was completely frozen. At the same time, we had put samples of the deicer in the freezer so that it was at the same temperature before we started the test. Then I used a micropipette to withdraw 30 microliters of the deicer. The dark ones were put on neat. For the clear ones or the light colors, we added a dye so that we could actually track the progression. That was put on the surface in the center of the cone, and then we track every 10 minutes the progression or the millimeters that the ice penetrated from the deicer. Sample representatives for you here, for these are for the pure ice penetration test. The 75 and other cuts are in the full report. If you notice on the top right-hand side, that is the trend line with time. At 0 degrees Fahrenheit, the ice has only worked for about the first 15 minutes. They had melted some of the ice, and then as the deicer was penetrating, the melted ice refroze and prevented it from penetrating any further, which is depicted by a flat trend line from 30 minutes on. The best performer at 0 degrees Fahrenheit within the first 15 minutes was deicer H, which had an average of 7.8 millimeters, followed by deicer F with 7.6. We also have tested at 15, but on the bottom left and right-hand corner are the results for 25 Fahrenheit, where all the deicers continued to progress and penetrate throughout the entire hour of the test. No one really refroze. The best performers at this instance with deicer E and deicer H. Deicer E at the end of hour had progressed 11.4 millimeters, and deicer H at 11.2. Can everybody hear me? I don't project as loudly as Bill. Okay. Huh? Just a little bit. The test that we spent the most time on, where we did the most different combinations, was the SHRP H205.2, and this is for liquid deicers. The test specimen shown in the picture on the container, we had gotten the 11-inch, I believe 2-inch acrylic sheets cut, and then we took it down to the machine shop and had them laid out the actual bowl size. So the difference is it's one solid piece, so there was no leakage whatsoever. To start the test, we would take 130 milliliters of our deaerated RO water, pour it in the dish, put it in the freezer at the specified temperature, let it freeze for a minimum of 2 hours, and then we would take a same size aluminum dish, disc, put it in the center of the ice, twirl it, the students call it twirlies. And what that would do, it would create enough of a friction to melt some of the ice that was on the top, smooth out the surface so it was as smooth as possible, and distribute, make sure the water was distributed all the way across the top. The aluminum dish was removed out. It was placed back in the freezer to freeze overnight to initiate the test, to specify temperature. Prior to initiating the test, we took the syringes, weighed them, withdrew roughly 3.8 milliliters of the appropriate deicer, weighted again with the solution in the syringe, put in the freezer to make sure it was at the specified temperature. We would start to initiate the test by dispensing the solution from the syringe on across the top of the surface of the ice. The syringes were allowed to cool back to room temperature for at least an hour before it was measured again, so we could get a complete mass balance of how much was actually applied in grams. And then every 10, 15, 20 minutes until the end of the hour, we used different syringes to withdraw, tilt the dishes on their sides, withdraw the volume of the melted ice and the deicer, record the volume, and then disperse it back onto the surface. Another student used ASTM method D1122-16 to get the densities of each of the brines tested. That way we can convert the milliliters of ice melted per gram of deicer applied to gram per gram. Some of the issues that we had when doing the test, because I'm very, very visual enough and make sure that we take pictures for everything. On the top left-hand corner, on the right side, were the refreezing issues. This was very visible when we had the dark deicers, particularly at 0 degrees Fahrenheit. The bottom right is a pure deicer that halfway in, even though if you had tilted it and it's completely on end, none of the deicer would move anymore because the ice that had melted refroze and incorporated or trapped the deicer so it couldn't move. This was also depicted when we continued tracking the volume with time, the milliliters that we could extract decreased. So those two went hand in hand. It was less pronounced when we cut the deicer with brine, which is on the top right-hand corner. Another issue was for precipitation. Some of the deicers, when we cut them with brine for some of the tests to do the melt test, would form, instead of being clear, it would form a precipitate, whether salting out or cross-reaction, weren't sure, of different solids. If you kept it in solution, you then, and put the syringe in there with the precipitate in there, it would prevent all of the deicer from being discharged into the syringe, and for some of them, it translated to 0.2 mils that was kept when we measured at the end. If you didn't mix it up, it might have decreased the efficacy, but it also interfered with the nozzles in the syringe itself. So that's something to keep in mind when you're cutting. So the things that we test, we did pure deicers at all three temperatures. We did deicers cut with different percentages of brine, so 75 deicer, 25% brine, down to only 10% deicer, and this was done at all three temperatures. And I'll talk in a moment about the other two temperatures we tested, but the specified temperatures for the methods were 0, 15, and 25 Fahrenheit. And we did not want to vary the test when we started off with it because we wanted to follow the procedure. If you vary it at all, then you're not following the standard procedure. On the bottom left are the results for the pure brine at 0 degree Fahrenheit. Most of them didn't fare too well at 0 degrees. They tended to freeze within the first half an hour, and you notice that there's a trend as the ice melt gram per gram would go up for the first half hour and then start to drop. Some of them froze, and it gave an artificial negative gram per gram. That's not possible. It's just the mathematics behind it, but it just got trapped. When we raised the temperature to 15 degrees Fahrenheit, things got better. The best performance here was the Deicer H. It had steady performance from 0.6 grams per gram within the first 10 minutes and ended up at roughly 0.7 grams per gram. And that's the graph on the bottom right-hand corner. The Deicer F had peaked at 30 minutes at roughly 1.5 grams, but then it dropped below the performance of the Deicer F within the last hour. And again, this was just applied on the surface. There was no friction. There was nothing to mix it up. So it's just whatever would happen from the melting and trapping. The best overall results were when we increased the temperature to 25 Fahrenheit. All of the deicers had positive numbers throughout the entire test, although some of them had peaked at 30 minutes. For instance, the bottom purple triangles is for deicer D. It had achieved 1.5 grams per gram within the first 30 minutes and then pretty much tapered out at that point in time. The best performances, the ones that depicted a sharp incline for the first 30 minutes and then a continued rise, was deicer E for the second best performance, and it stopped at 2.7 grams of ice melted per gram of deicer applied. Deicer H did an outperformance of 3.7 grams per gram, and remember that number because of the next slide we're going to show the pure brine, and deicer H, at least at 25 Fahrenheit, outperformed the brine. And here's the for the brine for the three different temperatures. We did this as a control. At 0 degrees Fahrenheit, brine fluctuated at zero grams per gram and then completely refroze as the time progressed. I looked and did some literature. There's other researchers, I believe it's Shi et al, that also said that brine's not effective if it's below 10 degrees Fahrenheit and it would refreeze. When we had 15 degrees Fahrenheit, it stayed positive through the entire test. And at 25 Fahrenheit, it did its best results, going from 2.6 at 30 minutes up to 3.4 grams per gram, but that was still slightly less than deicer H. The bottom table is the results for the 75% deicer. We have similar tables for every combination that we tested. And so we have on the first half, we've got the melt test data for 0, 15, and 25 Fahrenheit, as well as the ice penetration, and what we would recommend. There were two deicers, E and H, then when they were cut with 25% brine, that were good at any temperature tested. Other deicers, they did good at one temperature, maybe not as good at others. Most of them, if they were not going to do well, was at the 0 degrees Fahrenheit. So then we were talking because we had extra time, and this was following the traditional test. The different cuts with 50% brine, 70% brine, and 10
and 90%, Brian, are in the full report. Bill wouldn't let me go nuts with all the graphs and figures. He said, keep it simple. But that's in the full report for ODOT. We had some additional time. He goes, well, I know you want to stick to the standard test, but ODOT cannot get something applied within an hour and come back in a time and again. So we thought about extending the test for 2 hours because that was closer to a typical application rate. And we were still using the traditional temperatures. We didn't test it at zero because if it failed within the first hour, extending it for 2 hours wouldn't really get you much. And everybody was doing good at 25 Fahrenheit. So we did the second 2 hour test at 15 Fahrenheit. The table on the right is the average gram of brine that was applied for the triplicate tests and the standard deviations. I used a very high-tech analytical balance so I could get it to that level of standard deviation and significant figures. Deicer Pure H performed the best within the first 30 minutes. It was doing pretty good up until an hour and 45 minutes or 105 minutes. It had about 0.1, but within the last 15 minutes of the test, it refroze. The only deicer that did not refreeze through the entire 2 hours of application was deicer E. It was a little underperforming within the first test when you compare the top two curves of E and H, but it stayed positive throughout the entire test. It didn't refreeze. It ended up at about 0.1 gram of ice melted per gram of deicer applied by the end of the second hour. Brine was good for the first hour, and then it pretty much failed and tanked for the second hour. Sorry. Okay. Bill's going to talk to you, I guess, about some of the things to keep in mind for limitations, and then give you an S-curve where, because we also did two other temperatures. We looked at 18 degrees Fahrenheit for two, well, and tracked it for 1 hour and 2 hours because that was halfway between the 15 and 25. Some did really, really good at 25, not so much at 15, so we were trying to find out how would they perform in the middle. The students are working tirelessly right now on what the temperature was for 1 hour and 2 hours at 7.5 degrees Fahrenheit because some did well at 15, froze at zero. So we're trying to find out what some additional works were.
Okay, so again, we talked before about some of the weather data. We've also talked about, let's look at some cost comparisons between, and then ultimately we were trying to come up with what does ODOT look like, if you will. And basically what we did is we took the ARWIS data from the state of Ohio, and this blue S-curve, that's the generic, or that's the actual 1 hour distribution of temperatures across the state. And so what that basically says here is that as you're looking at field data from temperature, and this is from December 1 through the end of March, and it has no, it's not if it's snowing or not, it's just the whole, I'd love to say the end of March, we're out of snow season, but in Ohio, April still came on, so we figured that was pretty good. Other things that we wanted to look at is basically the way we're looking at this is from this point forward to the right, about 21 degrees, we were feeling comfortable that the field data was able to do it. And again, that's just based on how much data we collected in the field and the different temperature ranges. Below that, we started integrated into that lab data. A couple other data points that I want to show you is that the y-axis is the cumulative distribution, x-axis is the temperature. So when you're looking at, you know, these below 10 degree days, that's really not that common of occurrence in Ohio. So that's one of those things to consider. So when you're really looking at field data here, you've got almost 85% of the winter is above that temperature, which I think if you would ask most people in here, that apply, that seems reasonable. So what we basically did is we said, you know, in different areas, for example, one, brine, all the icers and all blends, they all work. So when you're talking the mild temperatures, they all work. Second, when you come into this zone here, the zone two, this is our brine with an asterisk on it. We had 50% and above. Now, what we tried to do on some of those other deicers is we wanted to cut them as much as possible. We ran them for all the different test, but we wanted to go with what would be the cheapest solution with that brine deicer mixture. So if it works at 50% brine, it's going to work with 25% brine, 10% brine. So that was the critical beginning point. And then as you can see here, as we start moving into colder temperatures in the lab, you start running out of options there in terms of, so for example, here in zone 4, deicer D, full strength, E and H full strength will work. Deicer E is 75%, and deicer H is 75%. Those will work. And the 75% would mean 75% deicer, 25% brine. So those would work in those scenarios. The next thing that we looked at here is what was the cost of brine? Because that's always been one of the challenges between comparing brine to deicers. It's more than just one scenario. We looked at the capital cost of purchasing, and again, this is with the help of Summit County, about a 3,000 gallon per hour brine major, somewhere around $47,000. Lifespan about 13, and then we did some economics in there. We looked at labor efficiencies, and again, we tried to boil this down as best as we could in terms of all the different components that would be associated with making brine moving forward. And then you can see the brine cost at the top is the salt cost, the labor cost, the water cost, the electrical cost, and the capital cost associated with the particular brine solution. We simulated, so we took back here again for each of these, we took a distribution of each of these initial components and then we went ahead and simulated what the cost. So we said a remodeled with a capital cost of about 130 grand. Basically, with the data that we got, it's between 14 and 18 cents a gallon is what it's costing us right now to do brine. And you can again see the distribution of costs in the top left and the top and the bottom left in terms of our simulations with brine. Coming back down, what we looked at is again, we looked at, we're trying to compare two things. One is how good is the deicer or brine in the field? And then we had to compare it to how much does it cost? Because the bottom line is when you're looking at it, we want to use the cheapest product that's going to work the best. So we did the deicers are on, you can see the A through H. We looked at the minimum and maximum suggested that we were applying. We looked at an average in there. We looked at a cost per gallon, and then we tried to then negotiate or multiply that out for a cost per mile basis for an application rate moving forward. Coming back down, then we also looked at if we took the deicer and mixed it with brine, and we could start looking at there again, how much would those different costs be, but again, 75% deicer, 50% deicer, 30% deicer, and 10% deicer. And again, we use as a control about 17 cents a gallon for the brine. Bringing back down here, we went back to that S curve. And so basically we said, what's the most cost effective that would work. So the field data there, so that zone 1 above 21, stick with brine, and 2 was brine or the 10G, 3 was the brine or the 30G, and then at 4, that really cold, we recommended deicer D as you go down to those really cold temperatures. And then with that, that's our analysis. So if you have questions for us, hopefully we can answer them.
Do you have any questions in the room?
Well, no? You did say that A through H is going to be released September 1st.
Yep. We have a final discussion with the panel here. But that will be that's right, we are releasing the deicers, yeah.
Like this, today's roundup discussion was available to non-ODOT entities as well. Is that information going to be available to us as well?
Yes, yes. All of this will be readily available, the final report with all the various testing that we've done, it's all going to be there. So you will know exactly what everything is.
Your grams with temperature, was that, I didn't catch it, pavement or air temperature?
Air.
Air, okay.
And we have a question online about whether or not you had any gel issues at different mixtures.
It was in the lab. So some of the deicers were viscous, and if you cut them with brine, the viscosity decreased. We did not see anything where it went from something that was more of a liquid to be more thick or more viscous. The other issue was just the precipitation forming when it was cut with brine, but no gelling per se.
And the precipitation did affect the nozzle here.
Correct. Okay.
Which can, so at ODOT, do we have that issue?
When we've cut calcium fluoride and brine, when we cut to a 50-50 gel and cold temperatures, colder temperatures, it.
I don't know what form of brine we had. We just had, I know it was just
right.
brine. But
right.
we noticed the precipitance that was there,
right.
and it was cause the syringe to clog.
Yeah.
So they can hear
speak
you.
Up so everybody can hear you on the phone. So.
Okay.
So I mean, but with us though, when we would cut it, we you know, this is in quite a bit in our tenure, we've realized we couldn't cut that certain product that much because it would gel on us and freeze. Or, you know, gel up and plug the nozzles, plug the lines, all that type of stuff.
Okay, so we have another question about if there's any significant differing results between applications during the day versus night.
I know Mallory's running stats now, but I don't know if she's done.
No, we did not see a huge change there.
Hey, Jill, Randy Sanders, got a question for you.
Hey, Randy, this is all here because of you, buddy. You ask away.
Yeah, don't blame me for everything. Hey, I've seen a lot of mixtures in there where it was deicers, like heavy amounts of deicers. We'll say 75% deicer, 25% brine. I think a lot of the people here, and including us, that we, you know, we're trying to mix like an 80% brine versus 20% deicer. Did you? And I realize there's a million combinations you could have done, but was that one part of the test? And I apologize if I didn't see it, if it was in there.
So we also did a 50-50 mixture of deicer brine. We did a 30% deicer, 70% brine, and a 10% deicer, 90% brine. And all that data is in the full report. But a lot of them, when it was less deicer, more brine, didn't perform as well as either the pure component or the lower mixture of brine.
Fantastic. And did anybody at all do any pretreatment test at all?
I did not do a pretreatment test in the lab. I just followed the standard methodology that was recommended. And I do not, I don't know anything about the field.
In the field, we basically the way it worked in the field is if we knew there was an event, we would call either Chardon or we would call Boston Heights. We'd get out there as soon as we could with relationship to when the field, the study was, and then we went ahead and applied. And then we went ahead and tested. And we had to be careful to make sure that at some point that the storm got real bad, we started plowing and the test was canceled. You know, it was just whatever was in the field was in the field.
Thanks, gang.
All right, so another question came in. Did you try application rate variations or just stick to the ODOT recommendations? And by rate application changes, I'm asking if we bump rates to like 80 gallons or more versus the 20,
and
the 40.
And the field we did the suggested numbers because we didn't have a whole lot of tests. So we ran out of time to do a whole lot more. And then that's where we picked it up in the lab. The goal originally was, yes, we're going to do a whole lot of different rates just to see, let's do double, let's do half. That first year when we were in the cul-de-sacs, we did. But again, that was just kind of getting to know the product and not having volume. So that's that. But once we got to the low and medium volume roads, we did not change it. And then ultimately, the other reason for that is that the brine worked just as well at the normal temperatures. So cutting it wouldn't have made a whole lot because you would have just gone straight to the brine at the 22 degrees plus. Yeah.
Bill, we didn't have the handouts, but can I assume that there were no tests of treated salts?
So, we have, that's not included in this report, we do have, what is it, 8 salts that we looked at from various to see what their properties were. But we used the standard, whatever the standard salt. To answer your question, yes. So we had, back in the day, we had some Moroccan salt, and we had some salt from the different mines. Where else did we have that from? Do you remember, Frank?
I just got a container that said brine.
Yeah, the clear line.
Yeah, we had a bunch of them. We could put that in the report. Yeah, that kind of just looked at what was their... Are you asking, like, what was their chemical makeup of the salt?
I'm asking about treated salts with the deicers that you were testing. So was there the salt that was treated, so no solid deicer testing?
Just liquid.
All the salt.
Okay, that's it. That'll conclude our presentation for now. This will be on the website. This is recorded, and the report will be available by September 1st with all of the names, vendors,
and all the data.
All the data.
Yep.
Okay.
Thanks.
Thank you for attending.